I'm not going to give you a sort of a straight off the cuff kind of a discussion about what these laws imply to me as a researcher and some of the implications and the difficulties we face, so some of these challenges. So next, the talk is going to focus on primary tissue-based research, as we heard all along. And I'm going to speak to the ethical and legal demands on biomedical research in Singapore, particularly relating to tissue-based research. And I will speak to the PDPA 2012, the HBR Act 2015, the human tissue research documents by BAC in February 2002, and the ethics guidelines for human biomedical research in June 2015. And I will talk about tissue issue of consent, which is quite a big area, and I hope there's enough time that we'll talk a little bit about the research exemptions and maybe incidental findings. And if there's enough time, you can speak fast enough. My nickname is Machine Gun Tan. I might be able to talk about the response to PDPA. So first of all, the scope of the PDPA and the HBR Acts. Now, as you heard, originally the bill has some difference between the two, but in the sense that the two acts use different terms. So the HBR uses the term individually identifiable, which the definition of which is a bit different from the personal data referred to in the PDPA. However, now I understand that the definitions are now aligned, so I will just refer to personal data, which will be equivalent to individually identifiable data in the HBR. And here, we have got the definition here, and I've underlined a couple of important points. First of all, personal data does not have to be verified or true, and that's particularly important for research data because a lot of research data is not generated in the CLIA lab or a CAP accredited lab. The data may or may not be true, may or may not be what it says it is, but as long as there's a personal identifier attached to it, then of course it remains personal data, even if it may not be true, and there's implications about that. And this is about data that can identify a person. So it's not just about data about a person, it's data that can identify a person. There's a little distinction between the two. And thirdly, that even if the personal identity cannot be deduced from a piece of data, from a piece of tissue, but if it's possible to deduce the entity, the identity from that data plus in combination with other information to which the organization has or is likely to have access, then it becomes personal data. Now, working in a hospital where there's a lot of information about a patient in through many different databases, the clinical, from the lab investigations, from the case notes, so even the piece of tissue may not tell you who this is, but as long as it's got, say, a hospital number, you can identify the person because you have access to all other information which can then identify this piece of tissue as belonging to so-and-so. So they are really dealing with personal data most of the time for us in the hospital. The one of the biggest problems facing the researchers today nowadays is that the fact that we have technology that is able to enable us to sequence our whole human genome. So we can actually sequence every single gene in the body, and with whole genome sequencing techniques and the data arising from whole genome sequencing techniques, many publications, many journals require us to publish these kind of data in publicly held databases. So, and here from a very well-known journal says there are no exceptions, you must publish it out. Now, the implications, therefore, that we must be a bit careful about the inevitable release of personal data as a result. Now, you can say that, well, you know, it's a whole series of ATCGs, no, nobody knows who this person is. Oh, well, that is true, but you have to be careful because sometimes there could be inevitable disclosure. For example, I published the whole, through whole genome sequencing data techniques, I have published to say that a particular sequence of genes is associated with motor neuron disease. And then, well, you cannot tell who this person is based on those sequences. And then somebody writes in to the editor to say that, well, Dr. Tan mentioned that the set of genes or this gene is associated with motor neuron disease. We have found that those sequences are actually associated with dementia that is associated with neurological diseases. So maybe Dr. Tan is mistaken. He is associating the genes with motor neuron disease. Actually, no. He's associating that with neurological diseases that have dementia. Then, of course, I get very excited and I reply to say, no, that's not true, because the cases that I published, at least one of them is from a Cambridge mathematician who, you know, who has motor neuron disease. There is no dementia there. Obviously, you know who this person is. So the ATCNG suddenly becomes personal data. Now, what is biological material and human tissue under the HBR? So what's the definition of human tissue and cells? Now, if you look at that, you know, it means any biological material that's from human body consists of, includes of human cells, but there is also an exclusion under this act. So for the purpose of this act, the definition of human tissue excludes human biological material that's been processed in such a manner that their functional, structural, and biological characteristics are altered from the time of this kind of processing. Now, the question really, therefore, is what do you mean by that? So the moment you remove a sample out of the body, even before you remove the sample of the body, the moment you clamp the blood vessels that supply blood to a piece of organ, then molecular alterations immediately take place. Proteins can become dephosphorylated. Is it sufficient, therefore, to say that the moment I clamp it, it satisfies this particular criteria and say, therefore, there are no longer human biological material? You know, at which, how much processing is needed for us to determine that this biological material no longer falls under the purview of this act? So that is really an issue, and of course I think I see a parallel between this and this question about what is property in human tissues. Now, this is a very interesting case. I was a forensic pathologist before in my previous life, and this is a case where, you know, Kelly was actually an artist, and he was engaged by the Royal Royal College of Surgeons to draw anatomical pictures, and he engaged his good friend Lindsay, a junior technician in the Royal College of Surgeons, to provide him with body parts. And there were, you know, heads, there were all kinds of limbs and so on. And from these body parts, he made a cast, and then he created works of art which were exhibited. Now, he was charged for doing this without permission under the Theft Act. So that basically, the theft means you've stolen something from the Royal College of Surgeons and, you know, make these works of art. But then to satisfy the Theft Act, you have to first prove that they are property. Now, there's a common law provision that there's no property in the body or parts thereof. So the defense lawyer says, no, he didn't steal anything because it is not property. It's human parts, so therefore it's not property. And so the court had to decide whether or not he is guilty of theft by first of all proving, is that property or not? You know, it's always common among forensic pathologists to say that you cannot steal a dead body. You can only steal the shroud over the dead body. So it's not property unless, you know, is it property? So here the court decided, to cut the story short, that it is property, it has acquired property rights if it has been altered in some way through the application of skill. And in this case, the application of skill includes the preservation in the formalin, and that makes it a property. Now, it's some similarity between this and our current law. So you need some kind of processing, and if you have this processing, then it's outside of it. But the big question is how much processing is needed. Does the mere act of dissection makes it altered enough to satisfy the criteria and take it out of the HBR purview? It may not be, but those are questions that we have to think about. Now, the issue of consent, by the way, we run out of time, just open the trap door, drop through. So one of the issues here about the deficiencies in the current practice, because until now, doctors have been living in a land of bliss where we rely very heavily really on implied consent for medical encounters, and for, of course, operations, we have got written consent, but these are consent for medical treatment. They are generally not consent for education or research, and that is something that doctors may not realize. And there has been a proliferation of patient databases for educational purposes, for education, for audit, for research. But you know, these are not covered by the written consent form we have from the patient, which is for the treatment, not for education, not for research. And so many of times in the past, our databases may not have the relevant consent or notification. Patients don't even know that this information has been used for research. There is no mention about retention limits. There is the access policy can be quite liberal, especially on coded data. So even you may be working in a hospital, as long as I coded study number 1, 2, 3, or just with, worst of all, just the hospital number, I can access the data. And also we have possibility of waiver of consent by RB. RB says that it's okay, that means we can just use the data. Now with PDPA, these things are no longer just easily, we can just do the same thing as before. We have to consider all these because there are provisions for this under the Personal Data Protection Act. And by the way, it's not going to be the RB chairman that decides whether or not you can have the waiver of consent, is your DPO. I'll talk a bit more about that. So the organization under PDPA must notify all its data subjects of the purposes for which they're collecting and storing and using those data, and this must be specified and notified to the data subjects. Now, what is the nature of consents? Now, there are two kinds in broad terms. I think you have discussed about the broad consent or generic consent, which is basically I ask permission from a patient to use this piece of tissue or data for all RRB-approved research or very drawn in very broad terms. Or it can be very limited to say that I'm asking for permission to use this piece of data or the tissue for this particular project A. And then if I want to use it for project B, I will need to re-consent. So that is the limitation of the limited consent. The advantage of broad consent is apparent, but there's a challenge. The challenge is the quality of the consent is very difficult because I cannot foresee what possible research will use this material for in the future. So at the time I take the consent, it's difficult for me to say anything more than that, don't worry, the research is going to be ethical because there's a group of wise men called the IRB and they will certify that it's ethical, and if they're ethical, it's okay. Will you agree to that? So it's, the quality of the consent cannot be on the same level as the limited consent. But with limited consent, you've got two problems. First of all, you need to re-consent the patients every time you have a new project that makes use of that data or tissue. And secondly, you run against this issue on the PDPA. If you had not asked the patient for the permission to contact the patient, you cannot contact the patient for re-consenting. So therefore, you're trapped between the rock and the hard place. So make sure you have to take the consent right from the start, otherwise you cannot contact the patient. Then the other issue, of course, as alluded to earlier by Tracy, is about the consent in the case of minors. And this is very interesting that we now have introduced the concept of the GILIC competence to research on minors and the tissue donation by minors. So essentially, the person taking consent now has to make sure that he ascertained the level of understanding of a minor, of a child, to see whether this child has sufficient understanding and intelligence to fully understand what is proposed in the research procedure or in the donation process, and if also, then that consent has to be taken. Now, this is not an easy thing to do for many consent persons, consent staff. The next area in terms of the consent is the problem, and it's a problem for me as a biobanker particularly, is that of the post-op consent. Now, for the HBR Act requires consent to be taken before research, but unfortunately, it lumps clinical research where a patient is subjected to some intervention. So you're going to give me a new drug. Obviously, you need to have my consent before you give me a new drug. But it lumps that with biobanking activities. So in biobanking activity, you have already got my consent for the procedure. The specimen is already taken out. You're asking me for permission to use the tissue that has already been taken out legally and ethically for the purpose of research. Why can't the second consent be taken after the operation? Why must that consent be taken before the operation? The risks are this. In the children's hospital, you have children with very life-threatening brain tumors going for emergency operations. And the parents are in a very distressed and harassed state. They gave the consent for the operation to save the lives of the children, and that consent is necessary. Now you are saying, because of this law, we need to go to that very distressed parents and take consent for the tissue that will be taken out for the purpose of research. And I have to do it now. No, 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 I cannot wait until your child is a bit better, then I can go back to you and take consent, because other than that, later I will go against this law, so I cannot take consent. Now to me, that does not make sense. It makes sense to have consent be taken before research, but not necessarily consent for tissue banking to have to be taken before the operation. So I think that's one big issue here, that there seems to be a failure to distinguish between consent for surgery and the consent for tissue donation. Do I have enough time? Okay, so I'm going to talk about the consent in the case of deceased persons. That's another particular area. The PDPA does not apply to personal data of persons deceased more than 10 years. So after 10 years, a person is dead for more than 10 years, it ceases to become personal data, so it doesn't come under the purview of this particular law. Now, in the case of PDPA, there's no provision for proxy consent. You cannot ask the wife to take consent from wife in place of the deceased person, for example. But the HBR is different. The HBR allows consent to be taken from social proxies. So you can take from a whole hierarchy of persons, and so there's a difference between the two. The implications, therefore, are that if you have done that for one, the criteria are different, and so you must be aware that you may have satisfied the criteria under one law, you may not have satisfied the criteria under the other law. So this is something for us to consider. Finally, I'm going to talk about waiver of consent. And now I'll see whether chairman allows me any more time. So the third schedule of the PDPA provides for the use of personal data without consent, subject to conditions in paragraph 2. They can allow that for research, and we refer to this as a kind of a research exemption. The question is, what are the criteria, what are the conditions for the research exemption, so to speak? Here, you can use it without consent if it cannot be reasonably accomplished, the research purpose cannot be reasonably accomplished without that a waiver. If it's impracticable for the organization to seek the consent, the data will not be used to contact the persons and ask them to participate in the research. The linkage of the personal data is not harmful. Now, the question for us as a researcher is, what do you mean by impracticable? And this is a big problem. So the implications is this: very difficult to satisfy. There are many qualifications. The qualifications are not very clear as to what is impracticable. And as they say in the book of Judges, when the people are not clear, they do whatever is right before their own eyes. So one person will say that, you know, impracticable means more than 10 persons that have to contact is not practicable. Another one says, you know, it's 10,000. Well, between 10 and 10,000, where do you draw that line? It's very difficult. So we go to have a problem where certain institutions say more than 50 is not practicable to contact them, and for others, no, it's too low as a threshold. So, you know, that is one big problem. Second problem is, who gives the research exemption? That is granted by the data protection officer, not the IRB chair. Now, who are the data protection officer in the public hospitals? These persons are usually administrators who they are not very familiar with the research, and that becomes a problem. You can either have two choices. One, if the IRB chair says it's ethical, I will automatically stamp approve and all give all the research exemption, or I will never give a research exemption because I don't know what it's all about. So that is a big challenge. Next, the criteria for research exemption with this is talking about HBR Act. The HBR Act has a similar kind of wordings for the research exemption, which I will just move on because it's the same. Now, have I reached the end of my time? I have.
Oh, this is an interesting part. Go on.
Okay. Let's talk about incidental findings. This is the big problem. So findings that affect the patient and, what are research incidental findings? So there are many different kinds of incidental findings. I want to research in something, but I found something by the way, okay? And there are many categories. First, it's quite simple. You take blood from normal persons as part of an epidemiological study, and you found you have elevated blood sugar. Should you return the information that this person may have diabetes? Well, you say, well, of course, logical. We should do that. It's an ethical thing to do. Then you go on further. What about findings which are not currently actionable? I won't use this particular example. I will say that we do a GWAS study on the children, and I found that a particular child volunteer, perhaps, carries a gene that confers the susceptibility for hearing loss, and this child is engaged in the music school. Is this clinically significant? Some would say not quite clinically significant because he's not going to die from it, but some would say maybe it is clinically significant, but is it actionable? Not actionable. Well, do you return that information? What about some information which doesn't even affect the patient? I'm interested in prostate cancer. I take the prostate of a person with prostate cancer. It's a man, obviously. Women don't get prostates. But then, in the course of the whole genome sequencing, I found that he carries a BRCA1 mutation, which means that his daughter may get breast and ovarian cancer. Now, is that information also to be returned? Do we have a duty to return the information, especially for physicians? What happens if his daughter is also my patient? Then I really have a big problem. Now, remember that, that I referred to this Singapore Bioethics Advisory Committee in February 2002, so that's more than 10 years ago, where they put this paper, and their position was a bit different with regard to incidental finding. The position then was that because donations of tissue should be treated as outright gifts, and donors should not expect any personal or direct benefit from it. So as a corollary, then there should be no requirement for the researchers and biobankers to disclose information, any incidental research information to the donors, unless they agree to do so in the first place. So that is basically the position of the Bioethics Advisory Committee in 2002. But the positions now may be changing a little bit, but what just to mention that it's a requirement under the HBR that as part of information to be provided for the taking of consent, you need to have a policy in place to whether or not you whether incidental findings should be returned. Does the patient want incidental findings to return? And I think that's quite important because you cannot just call a person up and put a piece of information that says, now you've got BRCA1 mutation, and you know, I'm not Angelina Jolie, you know, which everybody knows, I'm going to get married in 2 weeks' time. What does that mean to me? I may not want to have that information. So unless I give permission for the information to return, it's probably not ethical to just push the information down my throat. However, there are other people to say that that's a problem, because when I take the time for consent for incidental finding, naturally the question will be, what do you mean by incidental finding? Oh, clinically significant incidental finding, which are actionable. Very good. Give me an example. What are clinically significant findings? With whole genome sequencing, there are thousands of possible findings that you can find. Which is it that I'm going to talk about? And until I find the incidental finding, I'm not in a position to give you informed consent. I cannot get you a genetic counselor to tell you the risks of the problem. I can only tell you that they are clinically significant, but I don't know what they are. What about actionable? Well, whatever is actionable today or not actionable today may be actionable in 5 years' time or 10 years' time. So how am I going to give this kind of information? So if I cannot give the right information, I cannot get informed consent, so this requirement becomes a problem, isn't it? So one of the issue here is that perhaps the patients need to be understand about the implications of incidental finding. Beyond that, such a things like, you know, there are some implications such as that the information may not be accurate, they may have to be verified at your own cost. Just because I find a BRCA1 mutation in the lab, research lab, is not true, may not be true, it may be an error, so you need to validate that and you have to pay for it, you must be prepared for it, and then you know, you want that information. And of course, there may be implications on insurability and job prospects and so on. So patients need to understand the implications of returning incidental research findings. This is a big thing, it's not something simple. Now, should we make it a requirement to return incidental finding? As a researcher, as a biobanker, I think that would be very difficult and very dangerous to do so, because you just cannot give the right information to the patient to make an informed consent at this stage. So, One issue that has been raised is if the patient has been informed of a possible incidental finding and he decided, no, I will not accept any incidental finding, don't tell me about it, leave me alone, then you find a mutation or some condition that is very, very significant, that is potentially actionable as well. Not the difficult ones, not the gray zone, but very clear indication. Do you have a duty to inform the patient, even though the patient said earlier on, I don't want to know? Well, you can say that, well, the patient said, I don't want to know, I don't inform them. But then the patient is my patient. I'm the medical doctor. Is there a duty of care to the patient in this situation? At the time when the patient took the consent, the patient didn't know what incidental finding. It was drawn in very general terms. But now I have a specific genetic alteration. Do I still have a duty to inform that to the patient? And that is not an easy thing to deal with. So time's up. Perfect.